Blog Talk Radio.
Hello and welcome to Songs of Selah here on 17 Numa Radio. Thank you for tuning in this evening to episode number 111 of the show. I'm your host, Scott Thomas Outler, and it is Monday, June 22nd, 2020. Coming up on tonight's program, I'll be joined by poet and co-founder of the Broken Spine Artist Collective, Paul Robert Mullen. Paul will be joining the program to talk about his new collection of poetry, Disintegration, released through Animal Heart Press. And also joining the program will be friend of the show and founder of AHP, Elizabeth Horan. So please stay tuned for that conversation coming up in just a bit. Phone lines will be open throughout the evening at 646-668-8757. If anyone would like to call in with questions for tonight's guest and or to read some poems of their own, you're more than welcome to do so. And to kick the festivities off tonight, I'm going to hand things over to Mihaela Melnick for her weekly edition of Mickey's Poetry Cafe with a special Italian twist this time around. Take it away, Mickey.
Hello, Thomas. Hello, everybody. Well, this time I think I'm going to try something different, something new. And I'm not sure Thomas will let me do it, but I'll try it anyway. Okay. I'd like to read you a poem in Italian, a poem I wrote a few days ago. And I also translated it in English, but this time I'm going to read it in Italian just to make a gift to those Italian speakers that are passing by and stop by here in this cafe, and I hope you enjoy it. La moneta. Non sono mai stata così vicina a niente. Al limite sentivo il suono attutito di una moneta caduta sull'erba. Ed io ero da qualche parte tra cielo e terra, con un martello nel petto, sotto la mia veste d'avorio, non ancora scalfita dagli affanni o dalla concupiscenza. Ma ci sono uragani di forza minore e animali feroci mansueti. Esistono fuochi senza dolore alcuno se vi getto dentro la carne. E conosco modi per evitare o addomesticare, ma sono ignara di come controllare le droghe corporee e non so niente delle equazioni sentimentali o dei teoremi sull'amore, no, niente che abbia un senso, ma su qualcosa sul denaro e su come luccica nelle mani dell'avaro, e so che il fatto è scritto su entrambi i lati della moneta, nel sole accecante. Ed ecco qui la miglior conquista e la peggior sconfitta nell'insieme. Questa è la cosa più sensata che possa mai accadere nella vita. Grazie a tutti voi per essere passati e spero che abbiate gradito questa poesia. And thank you for stopping by and for having had the passions. And thank you, Thomas, for letting me do it. And catch you next time with a poem in English, maybe with the same poem that titled The Coin, the one I just read, and I'm going to read it to you in English. Thank you, and catch you next time.
All right, welcome back to the show. Once again, that was Mihail Melnick with Mickey's Poetry Cafe, straight from the heart of Italy and Rome. Coming up later in the show, we'll hear the second half of her segment with an English translation of the piece she just shared, The Coin. I do encourage listeners to please take a moment and subscribe to the 17 Numa Radio channel. It's easy to do and it's free. All you have to do is click the follow button found on the page where this episode is streaming, and that'll get you signed up. And a reminder to everyone that all past episodes of Songs of Selah can be accessed or downloaded for later listening from the archive here on the channel or from the Songs of Selah page at 17numa.com. Thank you to everyone who spreads the word about this program and shares episode links. Your support is always greatly appreciated. I believe that'll just about wrap things up here at the top of the show. Let's go to a music break now and then come back on the other side with tonight's guest, Paul Robert Mullen. Stay tuned. We'll be right back. Out there is interested in appearing as a guest on a future episode, please feel free to get in contact with me via email at 17numa17numa@gmail.com, and I'd be more than happy to get you set up for an episode later this year. Tonight's guest, Paul Robert Mullen, is a poet, musician, lecturer, radio presenter, traveler, and sociable loner from Liverpool, UK. He has 4 published poetry collections: Curse, This Blue Raincoat, Testimony, 35, and the newly released Disintegration from Animal Heart Press. He is widely published in magazines worldwide, and Paul is the co-founder and editor of the Broken Spine Artist Collective. So welcome to the program, Paul. How are you doing this evening?
Hi, Scott. I'm really good. Thanks for having me. I really appreciate you inviting me onto your show.
Absolutely. Looking forward to talking to you about the new book that was just released. And on that note, we also have on the line
the founder and editor-in-chief from Animal Heart Press, frequent past guest of the program, Elizabeth Horan. How are you doing, Ellie?
I'm good, Scott. How are you, my dear?
Doing just fine, thank you.
Good. It's always a pleasure and honor to be here, especially when I'm supporting one of the authors of our press. So it's an absolute pleasure. And I'm so glad we've gotten Paul online, and I'm glad your thunderstorms have gone through. Like, all is well, right?
Absolutely. We've run the gauntlet already here tonight, so should be
we have. It's like
from here on
totally
out.
Smooth from here. It's wonderful to hear your voice, Scott. Thank you for having us.
You as well. Always a pleasure to have you on the show, and looking forward to talking to you and Paul here this evening.
Thank you.
So I guess the first place to jump in is maybe talk a little bit about this new book that was released earlier this month and how you came to hook up with Animal Heart Press, Paul.
Well, I guess it comes down to Twitter, really. I mean, I know social media gets a lot of bad press, but actually, since joining Twitter several years ago, I kind of became very active in the writing community, of which Elizabeth is quite a leading voice, to be quite honest. And I recognized that she was very widely published and very highly sought, shall I say, and talked about. And I followed her poetry personally, as I did several other members of Animal Heart Press. And I can't honestly remember how we made an acquaintance. Maybe one of us, you know, saw another one's poem. I'm not really sure. But for whatever reason, I ended up sending my manuscript through to Elizabeth because I'd seen some of the stuff that Animal Heart Press had put out and was really impressed with it. And, well, maybe I should let Elizabeth tell the next part of the story, really, because she got back to me very soon, shall I say.
Yeah, a couple days probably, right?
Yeah.
I kind of think we met, I mean, we should say, too, that Paul runs Broken Spine Arts with his friend, longtime friend, Alan Perry, and I think that they accepted a poem of mine for their first issue, which was hugely
right,
exciting
yeah.
to me, and so then we chatted, and you probably said, I have a little manuscript here, and I said, send it over, and I mean, I read, I'm quite a lazy editor, I probably read the first four poems, and I said, yes, you know, if I read the beginning and the end, and I'm happy, then, you know what I mean, like, that's terrible to admit, but no, Paul's poetry is, and you'll hear it when he starts to read some, but it's quite different than mine. It's quiet. It has a skill in tone and voice that is so less loud and verbose than my poetry that it really intrigued me. And it's just beautiful. I mean, it's sublime and ethereal and quiet, and but it speaks volumes, and I just very much respect that gift of craft, because I'm not good at that. So I did. I accepted it right away, and off we went. And I don't remember what month that was, but it's been an awfully wonderful
ride. It was last year.
To work with
it was last
all.
Year, I think.
Yeah,
I'm pretty sure it was last year sometime, maybe late
Paul,
2019.
Maybe, or,
that happened.
Yeah. Mhm. And I believed in it 100% from the start. And we did very little editing, if any, of it. You brought it, like, polished. We can tell the story about me trying to edit it and how that
well,
went.
Well, you made some very valid suggestions, and even though I didn't go for all of the edits, you see, I'd already worked with another editor, a Welsh
yeah.
guy who also runs a very renowned press here called Black Bowl Poetry,
and
I'd worked with him on
right?
the poetry.
Matthew Smith.
Yeah,
mm-hmm.
We'd worked for
right.
months on the poems. And strip them right back to the, you know, strip the flesh away, and they'd become, you know, I don't want to say inch perfect, but as good as I felt they could possibly be.
Yeah.
So they'd already been through that process, I guess.
Right. It came very, very tidy. And I think what's interesting, Scott, is that, like, I wanted to add in, like, articles. I wanted to add a the or a, you know, like, I wanted, and I think what Paul and I came to realize is, like, I wanted to kind of Americanize it a little bit. And Paul very, very gently and respectfully said, you know, this is really my voice. And it is a British voice. You know what I mean? And I completely respected that. And so, like, I just think it's so cool, like, working together like that and being able to, you know, make suggestions, listen, and reach out, but also being able to say, no, you know, this is what I'm comfortable with. And then the editor being like, cool, you know, you're my author, you get the final say. And working with Paul has been awesome like that. Like, we respect each other a lot, I'd like to think.
That is very important to have that mutual respect going back and forth, especially when you're working on something in the artistic realm that's obviously so
totally
personal to the author themselves, and then you bring someone else
right
who's excited about the project on board, and they have their perception and filter that they're looking at it too. So to come to that common ground is a beautiful thing.
Mm-hmm.
Paul,
it
how
was
long
beautiful, and it was like, no, there were no hard feelings. It was just like we had this conversation about it, and then we went forward, you know, and I love that. Animal Heart Press is all about that, you know, like the voice of the author comes first.
Absolutely, letting that unique perspective shine through. And
yeah.
How long had you been working on the collection? What was the process of putting it together like, and what were some of the themes or topics that you were looking to center the collection around?
Well, I always have a joke with people when they ask me that question and say, if I think about it, it's taken 37 years to write it. But I guess those ideas that you collect over your lifetime. But really, I actually physically wrote it very, very quickly. One of my good friends who's a writer, when I told him this, he said it made him feel sick. But I guess I wrote all the poems in maybe three or four days. But that's literally all I did. So I spilt them in maybe 3 or 4 days, and then spent many months crafting them and editing them. As far as themes are concerned, obviously the title itself gives away one of the themes, which I guess many of us, particularly those of us that are creative, we go through this where we have some kind of breakdown which inspires art. And I don't necessarily feel that a breakdown has to be a negative thing. I see it more as a rebirth. So this collection for me is about a breakdown of some form. I think many people who've read it and reviewed it have seen that as a relationship, which is true, but not necessarily the whole picture. But I really like to kind of plug the positive side of it, that there is a part of this book which is about reflection and memory and recalling wonderful events in your life, such as your first love or the first time. I don't know, you went walking through a field with a potential partner. And then, of course, a breakdown in a relationship. And then the realization that the only thing to do is to move on. And there's your kind of theme of rebirth. So I guess there are three major themes that I envisaged as I wrote it. But maybe other people see other things. I guess once your book is out there, it doesn't belong to you anymore. It belongs to the reader.
Mm.
Allowing it to
That's
flow
great.
Into those new hands. So on that aspect of things, what do you hope that the readers do take away from your work once you've handed it over to them?
I would like to think that they are moved by it. I would like to think that they're engaged by it. I would like to think that when they read it, they don't, you know, acquire this sense of despair or see it as a miserable read, because I really wouldn't want that. I'd like them to see it as a kind of continuum from, the saying, isn't it, that it's better to have loved and lost than never loved at all. And that was the central theme for me, where I really wanted to plug this idea that there is light at the end of the tunnel. There is a future beyond the relationship that you may have thought was going to last forever. I want this to be a positive message and not a negative message, even though the title is mostly deemed to be a kind of negative sentiment disintegration. But I think, you know, it's like when you train a muscle, if you want your muscle to get bigger and stronger, you have to rip it and tear it first. That's what you do in a gym when you lift weights. So the idea of disintegration is so that you can put yourself back together in a stronger form.
Absolutely. That aspect of going through periods of chaos, breaking down, and then reemerging in that higher state of order. It's a key facet of life.
Yeah, sure.
The world and society.
I think something interesting,
going through a similar process at the moment.
With Paul's title, you know, when you think about the word disintegration, I feel like I'm conditioned to kind of think of that as something negative. And Paul was always kind of like, no, it's not. It's like a breaking down of something that hurt or wasn't working and a rebuilding, right, Paul? Is that kind of, and it just made me think about the word differently and about his book differently. Like, it's not just like, it's not sad. There's a lot of hope in this book and a lot of perseverance and, you know, right?
I really hope so, Elizabeth. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah.
It's not just
like a doomsday breakup. Yeah.
I'm really keen on the idea of, I mean, I guess this is what poetry is all about. I mean, looking behind the curtain to see what really is going on. And even though I would never, ever press a meaning on a reader, because I would never want that. Once it's out there, mm-hmm. it belongs to the reader and they interpret it mm-hmm. the way they want to. All I would say to a reader is, please try and see the positive elements in the book. At the end of the day, the character or the omnipresence that is narrating the poems is still there at the end and is a much stronger narrator than they were in the middle or at the beginning. I'd like to think it was a message of hope in that sense.
Hmm.
It sounds like once you got into the zone, you sort of got the full download. You said you wrote it all over a very short burst of time. Is that typically how your collections come together, or was that a novel aspect of this one?
It's typical of me, Scott. I am very much, you know, I can spend 7 weeks staring at my bookcase, looking out the window, you know, watching the squirrels in the trees, watching the clouds rolling off the Irish Sea, basically doing absolutely nothing, just waiting for myself to write the first line. And when the first line comes, maybe a whole book will come in a few nights. I've written half a novel in maybe 5 nights. I've suffered for this physically because, you know, I'm up till 5 a.m. But when that button is triggered inside me, I just have to do it. But then I could go another 4, 5, 6 months without ever writing a poem. But I've learned with age that I just have to step back now. And I really do believe in this kind of superstitious theory about the muse. And I just wait for the muse to come back. The only thing that I do when I'm not writing is I read like a trooper. I mean, I just devour books and I go and sit on a bench on the promenade, or I'm in a pub or a cafe, you know, when they used to be open before this crazy thing that happened. And I would sit in the corner and read, and I find that reading does then inspire you to, I guess, gain a different perspective. All voices trigger different voices, don't they? So influence, I guess. So, I mean, I'm just a very obsessive, compulsive person in that sense. So when the muse comes, I've learned to I just ride the wave until it peters out, I guess. So I guess it is typical of me to just spill something in a very short space of time.
Well, that sounds like you're coming at it from a fairly enlightened state of view, knowing your own process, and when the words aren't necessarily flowing, not being discouraged or worrying too much about being caught up with nothing to say, but just accepting it for what it is, and knowing and trusting in the process that when the time is right, it will come flowing once again. Not everyone has
absolutely that. No, I think you have to get to know yourself. And after 37 years on the planet, I kind of feel like I know myself pretty well. And I'm never going to be a Stephen King, you know, someone who writes a 500-page novel every 6 months. I'm looking at the idea, I mean, this sounds crazy, and I know I'm kind of manipulating your question a little bit, but if you kind of hope for a life which is going to be somewhere around the 80-year mark, I mean, I personally would be happy with getting to 80. I'd like to think that I maybe had 5 novels and 20 poetry collections. I'm not someone that's going to be ultimately prolific like some of the greats, I guess. But when that opportunity and that inspiration comes to you, you've got to capitalize on it, because when I was younger, so many times ideas came, and it might have been just as I was going to bed or whatever, and I thought, oh no, I'll come back to that tomorrow, and you wake up and you can't remember. And there's no more devastating feeling than that for a writer. So it's really important to capitalize on your inspiration when it comes. When that muse lands on your shoulder, you've got to use it, man.
Absolutely. When the door swings open, run at 100 miles per hour straight through.
There you go.
What was it that originally inspired you to be interested in poetry, and when did that then translate into the idea of seeking publication and going to that next level?
I never had a book out of my hand from about the age of 2. My parents and my older sister would tell you that books were always the most important things to me. So I don't know why I was so naturally drawn to books, but I was. And all the way through my schooling career, I was always reading. I was always in the library. I went on to do an English degree and a literature master's degree. I've always studied. I have an outrageously large book collection. In fact, I would confess live on air that I'm a bibliophile. You know, I've got far more books than I'll ever be able to read in a lifetime. And the idea of having my name on a book on the shelf in a bookshop has been the number one goal. You know, if you'd said to me, would you rather be a writer on minimum wage with your name on a bookshelf, or a footballer earning, I don't know, £100,000 a week, I would snatch the writer out of your hands any day of the week. So it's always been in the back of my mind. And I guess after university, I started sending some stuff out and got accepted in some really good magazines in the UK. And at the time, had no real idea of the significance of that. And probably then had 10 years off where I was still writing, but didn't pay any attention to the publishing world because I was too busy having a good time traveling and partying and doing all the things that a young guy does until I woke up one day and thought, my God, I'm in my 30s. What happened there? So I really got my head down and started submitting. And my work's been really well received. I mean, I'm published in over 100 magazines. I have 3 collections out with Coyote Creek Books, 3 full collections, and now this chapbook with Animal Heart. So I've really got aspirations to keep publishing and keep getting my work out there. And it's very therapeutic for me, very satisfying. I love the fact that I've got books on the shelf with my name on. I've worked really hard for it and will continue to do so. And it's just a very, very deep-rooted passion of mine that I have to try and fulfill. It's what I feel I'm here for, to write and leave something behind that, you know, shows something of what I was and what I am, I guess.
Nice to be dialed in to that purpose and know what your goals are and set forth toward them. It's admirable.
Mm-hmm.
And something Ellie
brought
up a little bit earlier in the show, she mentioned that you were part of the co-founding team of the Broken Spine Artist Collective. Can you talk a little bit about what that project is and what y'all are doing there?
Yeah, well, I was brought up in a town just at the end of the Northern Line. So really, we are kind of the very, very edge of the Liverpool region. All my family are from Liverpool. And obviously, Liverpool is a magnificent cultural and creative city. But the town that I was brought up in, which is just along the coast, called Southport, it doesn't have a great artistic scene. And it's funny because the guy that I set this magazine up with, the Broken Spine Artist Collective, is a guy called Alan Parry, who was a very good school friend of mine. And we went to college together. And then, unfortunately, Alan had some really kind of traumatic things happen in his life. And he maybe, you know, took some roads that that kind of alienated him from his friendship groups. And he was dealing with some really tough stuff. And I didn't see him for nearly 20 years. And that's quite regretful, but I'm glad that we kind of rekindled our friendship. We would go to watch gigs together. I think we went to watch people like Paul Weller and Joe Strummer out of The Clash. And we were into old music when we were young kids, you know. And I noticed that he was writing poetry. So I reached out to him and gave him a bit of a hand, you know, with places to submit to. And he's a very talented poet. And we met in a pub, you know, to say hello and have a pint together. And it was nearly 20 years, man. It was very strange, very crazy. And we just decided that we needed to do something in our town, based in our town. So we came up with this idea and we worked on it really hard. You know, we spent a long time coming up with a kind of plan, and we released the first issue in February of this year, and it was absolutely wonderful issue, and it featured 47 different artists, photographers and poets from all over the globe. If I think right, there was maybe 22 or 23 different nations represented in it, and it was a fabulous collection. And of course, Elizabeth was one of those poets that we published with a wonderful poem of hers. She's a real powerhouse writer herself, as you probably know. And last week we released our first chapbook, which was actually by the co-editor Alan Parry, his debut chapbook called Neon Ghosts, which is a wonderful collection. We really want to be a press and publisher and magazine of the highest quality, doing the right things for the artist. We're not in it for the money. We're pretty much non-profit, and we just want to put a stamp on our local area and encourage poetry and try and create a bit of a scene.
Certainly a great ambition, but a difficult time to start off a project like that with the coronavirus lockdowns and quarantines going on. Are there any plans once this phase is over to maybe launch some events there in the local area, as you talked about?
Yeah, we did a fantastic event earlier in the year that wonderfully Elizabeth was able to come to because she was on a UK tour promoting her latest book. And it just so happened that our event coincided with her UK tour. She was on a tour with a Welsh poet called David Hanlon. And we put on a fabulous event, which was sold out. It was ram-packed full of people interested in poetry and music. And we had live music performances, live poetry reading. We had a stall selling books from a variety of different authors. It was a wonderful event. We might have had a drink or two afterwards. And a thoroughly good time was had by all.
It was a magical night. I mean, I think I was reading in front of 40 to 50 people that night. I mean, how often as
That's
a poet
right.
in the States do you get that kind of audience? And, you know, like I go to New York and try to sell my books and read in the Bowery, and it's like, you know, I've told Paul and David and people that I was involved with there in the UK, like, I just feel like in the UK, people respect poets a little bit more. Like, people, when they come to your readings, they'll buy your books, damn it, you know? And they, like, clap after you read. And there's not this kind of, like, shyness of, like, am I supposed to clap? Am I supposed to snap? What do I do? Like, it feels like you're being respected for this high art you're putting out. And that was so fun. Oh my God. And we just had, yeah, it was such a special night. And oh my goodness, yeah. I'm already planning to go back there as soon as I possibly can, like next February, to tour with Paul and Alan and David, right? Right, Paul? We're going to go for
absolutely.
It.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm.
Yep. The four of us are going to take UK. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that sounds great. And we've got our second edition of The Broken Spine coming out this October. Mm-hmm. We've just done the submissions in April. We were absolutely inundated. We had hundreds and hundreds of submissions from all over the world.
That's so good.
Obviously,
that's so good. I'm so happy for you.
Obviously. Mm-hmm. Thank you. People are catching on to the fact that we are a quality publisher. You know, we put together this fantastic print magazine and we sent it to all parts of the world. And we were absolutely determined to do that for free because we believe that that should really be the minimum reward for an artist sent to work in. So anybody who contributes to the magazine gets a free copy and gets it posted to wherever they live in the world. It's not cheap and it's not easy to manage that, but we did it and we'll do it again. And that comes out in October. And I'm just hoping that the coronavirus crisis will be over by then so that we can get together in a room again and do something really special.
But could I say, too, like for Paul's launch, was it June 14th, my dear? Or what?
Yeah.
Blanking. Okay. So we did a Zoom. We did a Zoom launch, and I don't know, there were 20 people maybe, Paul. And Paul and I, you know, chatted for the first half an hour, and Paul read a bunch of poems. And then we had an open mic for over an hour, and it was so beautiful and supportive. And, you know, people from all over the world, from Twitter, from not Twitter, like it was, you know, it's like you do what you have to do. And I think having open mic readings on Zoom right now and continuing to promote the work, even though you can't maybe have a launch in your town, we stay connected. And as poets, we have to stay connected right now because the world is fucked and Twitter is scary and, you know, there's a lot of anxiety and stress, and the way I feel it to be released is like in this moment talking to you guys. And, you know, those are the healing moments. Those are the things that we need and look forward to. Otherwise, you know, my mental health's gonna just go down the toilet. So like I feel like Paul and I both believe very strongly in, you know, connecting and staying connected and working as a team. Like, I like to think our presses are kind of a team at this point, and that's an awesome feeling. Yeah?
Absolutely, yeah. Yeah, I think the smaller presses do such wonderful things for poets who are maybe marginalized and maybe find it difficult to get their voices out there. And let's face it, I mean, there could be so many superstars that never really reach those dizzy heights because there just isn't enough room at the top of the tree for those that amount of people. So these smaller presses that are also international, don't get me wrong, but the smaller presses that enable, you know, great poets and great voices to get out there, however small the audience might be, it is still an incredible achievement. It's an incredible sense of achievement for the writer. For someone like Elizabeth, who is a major mover and shaker in the industry, really, it's incredibly satisfying, clearly, for her to work with poets. I know she's done some fabulous work with some Nigerian poets, and all credit to her. I think it's wonderful to be able to provide that happiness and support to writers from all over the world, really. And I just think that what she does with Amanda McLeod at Animal Heart Press and the whole Animal Heart Press team is wonderful. I knew straight away that this was a press that I wanted to work with, and when they accepted my book, I was absolutely thrilled. The process has been nothing but a pleasure all the way through, and the final product speaks for itself, really. It's been it's been a really, really great process, and I would love to work with them again.
Yeah, and I hope we make that happen. And I stayed up till like 2 in the morning last night, way past what I should have done, and I was like tinkering around with like working chaps that I can send to Broken Spine Arts, because now I want to send something to them, you know, and so that's on my mind right now, because I feel like it would be the same kind of experience, Paul, you know, to feel safe and work as a team. And that's what it's all about. Like, I've had some bad experiences in the industry of publishing with people that either ghost you or have a complete implosion or, you know, get involved in the Twitter wars, and next thing you know, your book is obsolete. Like, there's some very unhappy things that happen to authors. And as editors, like, we've got to uphold the trust and the goodness. And, you know, it has to be about the authors. I mean, that is always my mantra. And I think Paul and Alan feel that way, too. It's not about your ego. It's not about money. About your authors that trusted you to send you a book, and by God, you know, that's what we're gonna do.
I really think it's beneficial to be an author, to then be an editor and, you know, a founder of a quality magazine, because you have then got experience and hindsight from both sides of the coin. You're not a business person looking to make money out of an author. You're an author with empathy who understands the process, understands how important it is for the writer, and can, you know, make the right decisions on the writer's behalf, because effectively you are publishing their work as if it was your own.
Right. And when an author sends you their manuscript, that is a massive act of trust, and when editors fuck that up, like, I can't stand it, you know. And I am both. I have been on both sides, and I think that puts me in a position to know how painful it can be as an author. And that is what drives Animal Heart, is like pro author all the time. And yeah, I just and you know, Paul and I, like, we've become quite good friends since UK and getting his book out. And I've been able to lean on him in the last few weeks with Twitter trauma, which is a very real thing. I mean, you can call Twitter real or not, but when it affects your mental health and disturbing things happen and bullying happens and it involves your books and people you trust, like, it's extremely traumatizing. And I think presses like Broken Spine Arts and Animal Heart are, like, giving some kind of light into the darkness just by their quiet strength and, you know, their actions, not their words necessarily, just their actions of love for authors and trust. Right, Paul? Like, Paul...
Yeah. Absolutely.
Stayed up and talked to me when I was just so, you know, hurting. And I think this is what we have to do as presses that believe in the same things, is, like, bond together and don't give up that good fight. Like, don't give in. Or, yeah. So I thank you for that, Paul.
You're very welcome. And, yeah, I think from mine and Alan's point of view, we're quite similar personalities, and we'll always stay away from that drama on the social media. I felt bad for you because, of course, you had books tied up in presses that essentially instigated the drama, and it's very mm-hmm. difficult in that sense. So mm-hmm. it's really important as a press and a magazine to be responsible for the author's sake, really, because, of course, the last thing you want to do is make an author's book go obsolete, as you said.
Mm-hmm. Right. I think you have that responsibility to them. I mean, it's kind of like a marriage, you know. I took this book in for you, and I will uphold it. And then when that falls apart, it's really painful. So I think both of our presses are pretty determined not to do that. I guess that's my point.
A little bit earlier, we were talking about artists and writers from all across the world and some of the traveling that's been done throughout the UK there. But, Paul, another interview of yours I was checking out recently, you talked about some of the extensive traveling abroad you've done in places like Australia and China and Spain and a few other places. Could you talk a little bit about some of those adventures and maybe how those impacted your philosophy on life and your writing in particular?
Well, Scott, I've had a wonderful life. I mean, I come from a working class family from a small town just outside Liverpool. And, you know, I have a mother and a father who worked very hard all their life and didn't have the same opportunities as me. I was the first one in my family to go to college and university and to get the chance to travel. I actually went to Australia to play cricket. I was quite a talented cricketer as a younger man. And I went out there and did reasonably well, but unfortunately I had a bad injury, which kind of affected my chances of ever playing at that kind of level again. So, you know, my life hasn't taken the usual course. I mean, at 37, a lot of my friends are married with kids and have mortgages and two cars parked up the drive. But a lot of them don't have any stories. And I have to reassure myself of that, you know, because I've been all over the world, really. I was just saying to Elizabeth before this interview, I've been to 52 countries, including some very strange places, like I lived in China for 4 years. I've been to North Korea. I've been to Myanmar, all over the East, really. I've traveled Europe extensively. And I really do have a kind of seize the day attitude. I wake up in the morning, I'm feeling good. I've got to use the day to do something positive. I love to travel. I love to engage in people's culture. I find human beings both kind of abominable and incredible at the same time. I love to mix with foreign people and observe life from a distance. I guess I'm a great observer, really. I like to sit in a cafe or a bar or, on a side street, sit on a bench and watch the world go by. And that's an awful lot of the inspiration for the work that I do, whether it be poetry or fiction or otherwise. So I've had an absolutely wonderful life. I feel incredibly grateful. I've had times like everybody else where it's not been easy for various reasons, but from where I come from, the background I come from, I think I've done pretty well. We've really, down to my parents and grandparents, I've had 10 times the opportunity that they've ever had. But I've got to give myself some credit. I've used it. I've gone out there. I've been brave. I've gone on planes with a backpack and done it on my own. And I really love travel because it's inspirational and it's enlightening. And I would say to anybody, the world is a terrible place at the minute. Anybody who's filled with hatred and prejudice and spite and all of these terrible emotions, get your backpack on, go out into the world, and you'll find kindness in every corner on this planet. And that will soon change your mind. I really do believe that traveling is a wonderful thing. And if you can afford it and you are able and you're healthy, and you've got to be a bit wise in these places because not everywhere is safe, but as long as you've got a bit of streetwise about you, you can go around the world and have the most incredible.
Can I just say one thing? Like, you're like, I've had such a great life, and I'm thinking to myself, you're 37 years old, darling. you're just
know,
a baby. You're I mean,
I just feel like I've lived forever,
Aww. I mean, you've done such, I think I've traveled and then I listen to what you've done and I'm like, oh my goodness, but like, it's just so cute because you're so young in my mind. You're so young,
think of all you still have to do.
What's that?
Yeah.
Looking back over the vista from his wizened years at 37.
Right. As if he's 80.
but obviously,
I'm
sure you have learned a lot of lessons throughout that. And one of the things that you touched on there that really piqued my interest was having been to North Korea with the firewall of information and the lack of knowledge that a lot of the rest of the world has of that area. Can you talk a little bit specifically about what that country was like?
Yeah, this goes back to what I said to you earlier, Scott, my kind of obsessive compulsive nature. I became interested in North Korea probably about 10 years ago, simply because a lot of things in this world that are weird kind of grip my interest. I can't explain it, but they do. Just to drop another bomb on you, I'm also an incredible Bigfoot enthusiast, but another strange thing that I'm into. But I became obsessed with North Korea. I was reading books. I was following the news about them all the time. I watched all the documentaries. I was particularly glued to this whole Dennis Rodman episode where he kind of by accident almost became the American ambassador to North Korea. He seemed to have more power there than any of the people in the Senate. And I just decided when I was living in China, because it was so close, that I was going to try my damnedest to get in. And I tried to get in for 2 years, and I ended up getting in with a group of British press through a tour group based in Beijing. And I tried to get in twice, and twice it was cancelled the night before. The first time they shut the borders because of Ebola. The second time there was no explanation given. I was stood in Shanghai Airport ready to board the plane and told that was it, we can't go. I lost an awful lot of money on trying to get into North Korea. But the third time and the final time, I actually got in. And it was the most bizarre experience. I've actually written 3/4 of a book about it, and I really must go and finish that, because what I experienced in those 10 days was extremely surreal. I do believe that they put a show on for us. I don't believe that everything that I saw was real. It was very strange that we had to be with two guides and police at all times. It was very odd that we had to stay in a hotel in the middle of a river and were not allowed out. We weren't allowed out full stop, let alone unattended. It was the same hotel that Otto Warmbier stayed in, the poor student, American student who, you know, probably for a laugh, just pulled a poster off the wall and got accused of some kind of dramatic war crime and was held in a labor camp in North Korea and eventually returned to America as, you know, a vegetable and died a week later. All of these things were spinning around my mind, and there was definitely an element of danger. I was staying in a room with a German guy I'd never met before. He was about my age, and he was very cool and a bit wacky, and we were kind of discussing a lot of things, and we were pretty sure the room was bugged. So you always have to be on your toes. Nobody ever smiled. It was a very tense place to be, but an incredibly beautiful place. Not only did we spend time in Pyongyang, but we went out into the countryside. And I would say that everything looked like it was kind of 70 or 80 years in the past. Everybody was dressed like you could imagine somebody being dressed in the 1920s or 30s. There was clearly an awful lot of poverty there that was hushed and brushed under the carpet. Pyongyang was the most magnificent city to look at, especially from like the 65th floor of this hotel. But there weren't any cars on the road. It was the most bleak and quiet capital city I've ever been to. And when I got out of the country 10 days later, I'm glad it wasn't 10 years, I was quite relieved, actually. But I also had this huge sense of achievement and thought, my God, I've actually done it. I've been there. And I didn't tell anybody, none of my family, I didn't tell anybody that I was going in because I was worried that they would be worried sick. I'm a risk taker. I always have been. That was one of the bigger risks I've ever taken. But did I enjoy it? Absolutely. And I do have a different perspective on North Koreans. I really do think they are someone, you know, a nation to fear. I think it's a terribly kind of twisted mentality and indoctrination that they've been through. I felt terribly sorry for the people. They didn't have a clue what was going on in the outside world, and they looked at us like we were aliens. So I didn't actually get to interact with any North Koreans other than the two guides, who were very lovely girls, but they were on a strict leash and said what they were able to say and wouldn't indulge in any further conversation. And it was all very strange and weird and surreal, but what an experience. Great holiday.
Yeah, good Lord. What a fascinating experience. And you definitely have to finish up that book you're writing about it.
I do. I really do. And the problem with anyone that's creative, I'm sure both of you guys will agree with me, is that when you get an idea, another three or four ideas will also fall through the door, and then you're spoiled for choice, and then you're pulled between ideas. And one minute I'm writing a poetry collection, the next minute I'm writing a novel, then I'm writing my North Korea memoir, and it all gets mixed up. And you know, I really need to finish it. You're right.
Well, absolutely, a time for everything, though, and I'm sure when the moment is right, you'll have another one of those download sessions where it all comes flowing out. Speaking about all those different projects that you have your hands in, let's get back to the most recent collection, Disintegration, that you put out. I think maybe I'll turn the floor over to you if you'd like to maybe read a few pieces from that collection for us, and then we'll open up the phone lines at 646-668-8757, and for the rest of the second hour, we'll start taking some phone calls in just a bit.
Sure, yeah. I'll read a few for you, no problem. So this first poem is actually the opening poem in the collection, and it's called Images. Wait until you see yourself in Spring Lake reflections. in the luminous, heavy-looking glass, in spiraling winds on plains in April. As months shift like blackbirds preparing broods in color, you will see yourself in teardrops, in autumnal mists over russet meadows, in spiderweb December snowflakes, in the first tomorrow you'll ever remember.
Very nice.
Okay. Thank you. I'd like to read another one. This one's called Chain. The daisy chain hasn't long broken. You sit beneath the cracked willow reading poems by Maya Angelou. I'm fixing it, I grin, twisting them round thumb and finger. Fix it so it'll never break, you whisper. So I guess that poem there would be one that I would, you know, certainly deem to be a more positive collection. That did actually happen many, many years ago when I was a teenager. And I recalled it all those years later, and there it was in a poem.
Typically in your work, how much are you taking from your own personal experiences and how much from observations of the world around you or other people you might know? What's the balance there?
I guess I am quite an observational writer. In this particular collection, a lot of the stuff was quite personal. So I would say that a lot of the things that I've written about in this particular collection are things that I recall from my own life, but that doesn't tend to be standard. You know, I could hear a conversation in a bar or in a cafe or a coffee house, and then suddenly turn that into a poem. I think the important thing for me is to leave that sense of ambiguity so that a reader never really knows whether it's me speaking or whether I'm just speaking through the lens of a poet who has observed it, I guess. So some of the work is very personal and some of it is slightly more distant, I'd say.
Okay, very good. And sorry for the interruption. I'll turn things back over to you if you've got another piece for us.
Sure, yeah. This is called When the Hearts of Two Poets Break. When the hearts of two poets break, they write all the things they'd hoped they'd never have to. Lie down too much. Ponder over playlists that exacerbate pain. Worship the object with irrational hope. Embrace tragedy like a sad-eyed dog. Message each other with encouragement that takes all their strength, as though the buttons on their cell phones are lined with lead. Hurl their hurt at computer screens with something resembling bravery, something resembling fear, nothing that is anything less than truth.
Very nice. So those three poems from Paul Robert Mullen's new book, Disintegration, available through Animal Heart Press. And you can go to YouTube and check out the cool book trailer available there as well. And I think what we're going to do now is go to a quick music break, and then we'll be back on the other side with Paul, Elizabeth Horan, and open phone lines at 646-668-8757. And we'll be back in just a moment.
Check, check, 1, 2. Roll through it.
Let's do it. 3, 4.
Down with the shine, the perfect shine that poisons the well and ruins my mind. I get took for a ride every time. Down with the glistening shine. It's in with the new, and it's out with the old. Out goes the warm, and in comes the cold. It's the most predictable story told. In with the young, out with the old. Down with the shine, the perfect shine that poisons the well and ruins my mind. I get took for a ride every time. Down with the glistening shine. A belly full of high dollar wine, a fat hand, a fat wallet too. Things change and get strange with the movement of time. It's happening right now to you. Down with the shine, the perfect shine that poisons the way.
If anyone would like to call in with questions for them or to read a few poems of their own. And first up with the callers tonight is from area code 618. 618, are you there, caller?
Hi, this is Beth.
Hey, Beth. How are you?
Hi, Beth.
Beth Gordon. Hey, how are you?
Hey, sweetie. It's so good to hear your voice.
Hi, Ellie. Hi, Paul.
Hi, Beth. How are you?
I'm good. I just have to say I'm going to put a hard stop to all this conversation about age since I'm going to be 57 this year. So I don't want to hear it from anybody, all right?
Well, Beth has the privilege of being the sage of our press as granny. Like, she looks out over all of us and tells us to shush when needed, you know, and it's actually an incredibly important job because otherwise we get too worked up, you know. And she just says,
"Hey,
I've lived through all of this, and y'all need to chill."
That's right. That's right.
Right?
Paul,
so thank God for you, dear.
Yeah. Well, no, it's. I think we all make a great team, but
yeah.
Paul, I wanted to say, because you and I haven't actually spoken before. I mean, we know each other through the press and through social media, and in fact, we published one of Paul's poems in the recent issue of Feral. But I love this collection. When Ellie sent it to me after I had joined the press, I think the first book that I got to kind of do some of the proofreading and stuff was Vanessa's book, and then came Paul's. And I absolutely believe in the idea, Paul, that you put your work out into the world, and then and the reader makes it their own. And so I started reading this book, and just because of my personal perspective, the first thing I thought after a few poems in was, who died? Like, somebody died. But I think it's because the language of this book is the language of loss, and it's just so beautifully written, but it is hopeful. I think the fact that the poems were written speak to the hope, you know, that you created these beautiful poems out of that sadness and out of that loss. And the one you just read, the Daisy Chain poem, is my favorite, so I'm really glad you read that one.
Oh, so nice.
Oh, thank you, Beth. I would agree that it definitely is the language of loss. However, which way you interpret that, and of course, you've got two options when you lose something, haven't you? You've got the option to get over it, and that's where the idea of rebirth comes in, or you've got the option to brood and become bitter and never get over it, which is obviously much more damaging in the long run. So, yeah, it's definitely about the language of loss, and then I would hope that the language of birth in some way.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, and I love the idea of disintegration because I think it just has so many potential meanings, but I think with any loss, there is that feeling of losing yourself, too, but then you can't become that new person unless you let go of the old person that you were, you know, before whatever the loss is. And I just think that theme in the book is beautiful. And I, like Ellie, really respect your craft, because you say so much with so few words. Mm-hmm. And I cannot claim to be guilty of that or skilled at that myself. I probably use too many words, but I love that about your poetry, is that I finish a poem and I think, you know, as short and as minimalist as it might have been, they're just so impactful, and I really respect that about your craft.
Well, thank you. And you know, Beth, something happened to me when I lived in China. You know, I lived in China for 4 years. I taught English Lit at Guangxi University in a city called Nanning, almost on the southern coast of China, just bordering Vietnam. And I was teaching there. And then a lady called Kay Evans arrived, and she was this kind of 50-year-old, long blonde hair, kind of surfer chick style, you know, being everywhere, done everything. she arrived with her husband, Dave, and they were just the most magical people. And she wandered into the apartment and introduced herself and said, "Oh, I'm the poetry professor for the next year." And my eyes lit up. I thought, wow, I'm going to be able to, like, become friends with a poetry professor. And we just struck up this fantastic friendship. And it was such a Chinese city. It was a city of 7 million people and less than 1,000 foreigners. So we were like celebrities. Whenever we walked out of the house, we got mobbed for photographs, and people just wanted to talk to us simply because of the way we looked. And the mm-hmm. only kind of Western, the only Western thing we had on the campus was a very small Starbucks. Now, I'd always objected to using the large chains. I'd always go in an independent shop in the past, but I really had no choice. And me and Kate would go and sit in the corner of Starbucks and share our poetry with each other. She was really responsible for getting me into this mode of really slicing the flesh to the bone. So when mm-hmm. I'd write a poem that was 2 pages, it would only end up 10 lines. And that's what you see in Disintegration. You see the poem in its barest form, which I really love that. I love the idea of minimalism, but it doesn't always work because some poets
right.
are so much more effective when they spill 5 pages. You know, some people need the space to be able to say what they need to say, and some people can say it in minimalist terms. And, you know, I don't, it's not wrong, it's different, isn't it? And I really think
right.
that.
No, I agree.
Yeah.
As you were saying that and talking about taking these poems and stripping them down to the bone and talking about that editing process with Allie and what you had done before, I think that the form of these poems mirrors the title, because the unnecessary words in the poems have disintegrated. You know, that you have really, again, that sort of act of destruction to create something beautiful. And I think the form of the poems reflects that. So I just think that title works on so many different levels.
Yeah. Well, I'd never really thought about it like that. Now you say it.
Yeah. Yeah, it just works on a lot of different levels, but I just love it. The first time I read it, I was like, oh, he's so sad. I read it again, and I saw, you know, I read more than just the sadness. It's really lovely. Well done.
Thank you.
Beth, how are things going with you and your writing of late, and do you have anything you'd like to share with us tonight?
So my most of my creative energy this year really has been focused on getting Feral up and running with the blessing of Ellie and with the help of Amanda. In fact, I think Ellie and I both know that without Amanda we'd be stuck.
Yeah, we'd be in big trouble.
So, yeah. We would be in huge trouble without Amanda.
Oh, yeah.
Because
she makes it all happen.
Yeah, she's the magician behind the scenes, making mm-hmm. you know, making Paul's book this beautiful object, and making Feral this beautiful creation, both on the website and in print. And so that's been a lot of my energy.
Feral has been such a gift, I think, to Animal Heart, because it has, like, lifted us and, like, I don't know, just buoyed us and given us something to focus on when things have felt crappy, right, Beth? Like, I don't know.
Yeah. I think it's been such an odd year. And, you know, we opened up submissions for the first issue of Feral, I think it was the middle of February, and by the time mm-hmm. we published that first issue, it was April 1st, and everybody was on lockdown. You know, mm-hmm. so in that 6 weeks from the middle of February
yeah.
to when we published that first issue, mm-hmm. all of our lives had just, you know, changed yeah. dramatically.
Yeah.
And it has, it's been something to hold on to. I've been doing
yeah.
some writing, not as much as I usually do, but like Paul, I'm okay with that. It's great to hear you say that, Paul, you know, that you're, there seems to be this sort of, mainly on social media, but this sort of pressure, you know, to produce, instead of taking a step back and understanding how your own muse works, what inspires you, and having the patience and the trust that'll come. So I've been doing some writing. I think that I will not read anything of my own tonight because I just like Paul to have more chance to read more of his work. So.
Okay. Well, we will get back to Paul shortly, and we've also got a couple more callers lined up. So, Beth, you're welcome to stay on the line if you'd like. And we're going to go.
Yeah, don't go, Beth. Stay.
All right. I'm here.
Love you, sweetheart.
Grandma, oh, Beth's nice. Here.
And we're going to go to another caller.
Hi, speak to you, Beth.
616 area code. Caller at 616. Are you there?
Yes. Hey. Good evening, guys. This is Steve, USA. Might not be known about the rest. Just wanted to say thank you, Paul. Thank you, Scott, for the platform. This has been purely a consumer of art. I don't have an autistic bone in my body. But that's one thing that strange goodness has come out of COVID is I have discovered how much I enjoy poetry, and I've just been so blessed by people, you know. I agree with Beth on the portion about the destruction necessary for creation, or at least the destruction of disintegration, but I think that's a necessary first step of transformation because nothing can be created if it doesn't take something else down, you know, in a reductive vacuum. I don't know. I just see it as a means of transformation. But I don't want to hog the line, but I do appreciate you guys.
No, absolutely. A good point there. And I'm sorry, could you state your name one more time? There was a little bit of static in the beginning.
Oh, I forgot where I'm sitting is a terrible cell location. Let me move. Steve from Michigan, Western Michigan.
Okay. Well, Steve, definitely appreciate
Steve.
You calling in and listening tonight.
Steve is a great
Hi,
supporter
Ellie. Hi, Beth.
Of all things poetry and my books and my press and Fly on the Wall, and it's wonderful to see you, Steve. Thank you so much for calling and listening tonight. Wonderful.
Yeah, all the contemporary artists that are practicing right now. I mean, I don't really have any affinity for historical, you know, high fashion, you know, the classics. I've just been so happy with everybody's voice now, you know, between the fight against racism, the everything, you know. It just means a lot to me. Energizes me.
Yeah. A lot of good support out there when we, yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. Contemporary poetry can use all of the fans and support and listeners and readers possible. We certainly dwell in a niche sort of setting, so the more the merrier people that get
right.
turned on to it.
I agree.
So thank you so much for calling in, Steve. And
yeah, I'm gonna hang up and go back to the stream. Thank you, guys.
All right, take care. Appreciate it.
Thanks, Steve.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
and we're going to continue along. We've got another caller here from Skype, so I believe this is probably Amanda.
Hi.
Hello.
Hey,
hello.
Hi. How you doing?
Hey. All right, so the whole Animal Heart Press team is in place now.
Mm-hmm.
As you should expect,
thanks,
Scott.
Right? Like, you, Scott, you didn't think we were going to get through this night without all three of us here.
I was just waiting on the numbers to pop up.
That's right. It's a loyal bunch. It's a loyal bunch. That's what holds us together. Amanda was at the chiropractor and then made time to come, right?
Listened on my drive home, and I just finished unpacking all my grocery shopping, so even poets have to eat.
Bless you for coming, honey.
No problem. I just can't sit down right now.
We were singing your praises, Amanda.
I did hear you. Thank you so much. I'm humbled.
And I think we should shout out to Amanda for the cover of Disintegration, shall we not? I mean, at some point we have to do that. So might as well be right now, that cover.
Yeah.
Fantastic.
Yeah, I would like to say...
It actually came together really quite easily.
Yeah. What were you going to say, Paul?
It's a superb cover. It really captured the mood and the... Yeah, I just saw it and fell in love with it. It barely needed tweaking. It was just a lovely background, and I love the kind of spiderweb cracks, which kind of hint at the title and the color and the lampshade. I just think it's lovely.
It was
a very easy one to work on, and I think probably what made it as easy as it was how quickly I was able to get my head around Paul's book and what it was about, and just kind of that blend of coming apart, but also of hope and renewal and walking towards something else. And I think that was quite easy in the end to capture in an image.
Yeah, it's like a coming and a going, isn't it? In that cover. It's simple, but it's complex, Yeah.
There are a lot more layers in that cover than you would think there are.
Yeah, exactly.
I've had such great feedback for the cover from people that have bought the book and been interested in the book. Many people have contacted me to say what a fabulous cover. And, of course, a cover really does sell a book, doesn't it? We always say the old adage, don't judge a book by its cover, but the fact is that many people do.
We do.
And if they were to judge my book by this cover, I would hope they would be inclined to buy it, because it's a great cover. So thank you, Amanda.
It was my pleasure. You are very easy to work with.
So how are things there in Australia? What's been going on with you lately, Amanda?
Well, finally, nothing's on fire. That's always a bonus.
Start.
But, of course, exactly. Of course, we've been in lockdown here with coronavirus, and I've been juggling the press with also having to homeschool my kids. I'm still garbage at high school math, things I have learnt the hard way. But we've started to ease restrictions now that the area of Australia that I live in has no active cases of coronavirus. So we've got school back now, and we've got our gyms are back online, and we're able to go out a little bit, which is good. Restaurants are starting to open to a few people at a time. So it's becoming more promising, and I'm just starting to find my new normal after everything got turned on its head. I had a really solid routine, and then it all just went wrong. that I've been trying to work through finding my new normal, because I'm a very organized person and I like to have a routine and a plan for the day. So I'm just finding my feet in the new world, the new ordinary.
Absolutely. I think that speaks to the concept behind Paul's book in general, the breaking down of old themes and what emerges from out that. Everyone's sort of going through their own personal journey in that regard these days.
Absolutely.
Well, I'd like to think that the positive from this whole terrible crisis is that the disintegration of our world as we knew it will inevitably lead to, you know, a much better place. I mean, you guys in America have got to get rid of old Donald, I think, and then we can press reset on the whole world, and hopefully coronavirus will make people understand that life is a very valuable thing and that we ought to try and get along.
I think coronavirus is definitely here anyway. It's made people and even big companies reassess their values and the things that are important. And one of the best things for us that's come out of this is in the aftermath of it, as people are starting to go back to work, one of the advisories was, if working from home has worked for you and it works for your employer, keep doing it. And a lot of places have said, you know what, we're okay, keep going. Stay at home.
Yeah, I think that's happening a lot with
the
major
gonna see a huge shift.
Tech companies,
yeah.
Google and a lot of the Silicon Valley companies there in San Francisco are really going to move totally to that probably.
Well, I can tell you that there is already a huge shift in the workforce happening in the U.S. My day job, when I'm not a poet, I'm an executive recruiter, and I can tell you that we're going to see a dramatic shift in what's important to people in the workforce, and a lot of individuals are already saying, why would I start commuting an hour, you know, each way to work again? And we've seen all the positive impacts it's had on the environment, you know, when everybody stayed home and isn't driving and isn't out kind of living life our old way. So I think it's going to be really interesting to see what happens in the, you know, in the next year in that regard. Sorry, I'll get off my soapbox.
No, stay up there. I love it when you get on your soapbox.
Paul, read some more of your poems.
Okay, sure, no problem. Is that okay, Scott? Shall I read another poem?
Oh, absolutely, please do.
Okay, this is called Dream Cave. The candlelight at the back of the garden somehow reminds me of you. I watch it burn deep into dreams, dancing on the zephyr, the tinkle of wind chimes. Watch fire bleed and rise onto cold stone. Take myself to bed, alone.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, that's a sad one, isn't it?
Yeah. That's a really sad one.
My two favorites.
So,
I was hoping I could get through so I could ask you to read my two favorites, but then as I was listening on the way home, my two favorites were the first two you read.
Yeah.
And he has such a beautiful reading voice. I mean, it's just mesmerizing,
yeah.
I find.
It is.
So. Mm-hmm.
Paul, I don't. My copy of your book is out in my car right now because I just came back from a week long, you know, self-made writing retreat, and I took a lot of books to read, so I don't have it in front of me.
Yeah.
But the poem where you talk about what your mother said to you about getting over that, about getting over the girl. To me, that's this turning point in the book to me.
Yeah, this is called Dave.
Yeah.
Okay. Dave. Mother said, why are you wasting your days writing poetry? Why are you spending your life in coffee shops, squandering your best years? Why don't you get over that girl? She was no good for you anyway. I told her, I never chose to be a poet. If I could, I'd have been a bird. And she shrugged in such a way that the days became heavier than the sun.
Oh, that's so good.
It's so good. Sublime.
Now, I do have to say that poem particularly is an observation. That didn't happen to me. That happened to another friend of mine that was a poet. My mother has been nothing but supportive of my writing, and I wouldn't want people to think that it was that's my mum's attitude towards my writing, because it's not. She is very supportive, and as all my family are. But that did happen to somebody else. So I guess that's where the element of observation comes into my writing. I felt desperately sorry for somebody that I knew whose family just didn't see the value in attempting to write. And I found it all very sad, and that's how it came. That's how it translated into a poem. So I just wanted to clarify that I wouldn't want my mum.
Yeah, you were able to translate that other person's experience and kind of integrate it into this book in such a way that it didn't feel like it didn't stand out in the sense of, oh, that didn't really happen to this speaker of this, of these poems. You know, it was, you, nobody would have known that had you not told us that it wasn't about your mom, you know, that you were able to take somebody else's story and make it part of this book that's so personal, I think is amazing.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Captured well. And we have about 10 minutes left in the show here. So hopefully you're going to get to another piece by Paul in just a moment. But if there's anyone else that would like to read a piece, you know, Ellie, do you have anything you'd like to read tonight?
Yeah. You know, I would love to read my poem that Paul published in Broken Spine Arts. I'm not sure I've ever read this before out loud, so bear with me and I'll do my best. It's not my usual poem. It's not dark and horrid. Okay. Finger sonata. Play a chord, any. They all touch me there. Your fingers, celestial harp, stroke. My skin taut and tuned, imparts the heavens, demons, angels, whispers. My waist dictates, my breasts demand. More, more of this ecstasy. God damn, I love you so much. It's like sleep and wine, something like barely enough. Sharpened strokes make new the music. Palms. Soaking milk as white, as lush as the frothing sea. See what your music, your Mozart invention, does to me.
Very nice piece.
Thanks.
That was beautiful, Alice.
Thank you. Yeah, I mean, for anyone who hasn't ordered the print copy of Broken Spine Arts, there you go. In there. I like it because it's not like... Yeah, go ahead.
I feel like I'm blushing now.
It was instantly accepted by us. When you see it on the page, it's even more stunning.
Yeah.
When you get a chance to read the words and consider them over and over, and both myself and Alan just loved it. And it was one of the half dozen poems in the first edition of The Broken Spine that we didn't have to debate. It was just in.
Thank you, Paul. Yeah, I was very honored to be in your first edition. Wonderful. Thank you.
Before we get to the end of the show, I do want to go to one more caller that we have on the line here from area code 620620. Are you there?
Yes, I am.
Who are we talking
with? Guys, how are you?
Who are we speaking with?
Can you hear me?
I'm having a little trouble hearing. Who is it?
This is Mary.
Oh, hi, Mary.
How are you?
Hi, Mary. It's our beautiful Mary from our family, Animal Heart Press. Mary has taken on our huge job of social media. Hi, Mary. I'm so glad you're here. Thank you.
I just wanted to call and tell Paul how wonderful the book is. And I have a question, though. I've listened to the whole thing. I just couldn't call in because my children weren't cooperating. You talked about how, or all the stuff that is going on, social media, the news. I wondered, Paul, how do you stay positive? How do you keep such a light outlook on life?
Wow, yeah, good question, Mary, and thanks for joining us. I guess as I've got older, I've become a lot better at seeing drama on the horizon and turning around and going the other way. So I find it easier to stay positive when you stay away from the storms. And I mean, don't get me wrong. I've seen some of the stuff that's gone on Twitter. Whenever the terrible thing about people is that whenever something fantastic comes along, and let's face it, Twitter is an incredible tool for all of us writers to be able to have a community and find out about magazines and publications, and maybe if you're as lucky as me, get a book published with someone wonderful like Animal Heart Press. And it's a wonderful tool for a writer to have by their side all the time on a mobile phone. But of course, with every angel is a devil, and there's some bad people out there, and these guys that use social media to manipulate women, and these guys that use social media to try and relay their racist, xenophobic, prejudicial views. I mean, as abhorrent as I think they are, and I really do, I also have to take a step back and try not to get involved in it, because I have seen some very good people, or people who I deem to be good people, get dragged down and completely decimated and destroyed by trying to do the right thing, or maybe they've been guilty by association and have therefore been destroyed, because an awful lot of people out there who think they're doing the right thing by, calling people out on stuff are actually damaging good people. So it's a very fine line between finding, who the bad people are and who the good people are. I always just try and see the positive in people and try and engage with those who are constantly being positive. And I have my own opinions on all these issues that have gone on, but I tend to try and be, take a step back on social media, because you can never really fully represent yourself as a human being the way that you'd like to when you're typing on a keyboard. unless you're face to face, you can't really give a full impression of who you are, and what your opinions might be. So I guess my personality reflects my poetry in that sense, that element of quietude. I would never get into a raging argument or debate on Twitter because it inevitably ends up damaging all parties involved. So my kind of tactic in life is just to take a step back and engage where it's safe to engage, always be positive and supportive, and, you know, spot the bad people and stay well clear of them. And you don't get it right every time. Of course we don't. I mean, some people that we trust and really believe we can trust turn out to be bad people. But, you know, you've got to forgive yourself for making that mistake and try and learn from it. You know, the 20-year-old me would have waded into those arguments and thrust my opinion. The 37-year-old just says, well, you know, it's best not to.
Wonderful.
Well said, Paul.
Yeah, hear, hear.
And I think it's, you know, like I said before in the show, like when you find kind of a sister press like Broken Spine Arts and Animal Heart, like to kind of, you know, bond together and like be like, I hear you, I support you, and let's both stay out of it and let's lift up our authors, like, gives us strength. And it's very muddy waters to navigate when things go wrong on Twitter, for sure, and has caused us a lot of stress in the last few weeks at Animal Heart. It has. But we also love each other and trust each other, and, like, I don't want to do anything else than what we're doing. And, you know, it's been hard.
I just want to add one final point, if it's okay, Elizabeth. The one thing that really irks me about this kind of stuff is the fact that, you know, if you have a press, if you have one bad egg in that press, one person that turns out to be a bad person, I think 90% of the people don't seem to understand that those people that are on board with that person on a press aren't necessarily the same. Unfortunately, one bad person can bring down a whole press, which I personally think is wrong. Because, of course, we're all human and we all make mistakes. Sometimes we associate with people that are bad without realizing it.
I think that's the thing, why can't Twitter see that everyone makes mistakes, and do we have to destroy people to make that point? And that's the upsetting part, you know. Of course we all make mistakes, and because we're human, you know.
The protest movements are fantastic because it gives the collective a chance to use the voice for good. The problem that you do have is that you have an awful lot of people that get on bandwagons who love the drama rather than the message, you know, and those people can be equally as dangerous. So, again, to reinforce my point from Mary's question, all the time, in my opinion, it's much better to stand back and stay out of the way of the drama, because once you acquire a bad name, even if it's unjustified, it's very difficult to shake that.
Mhm. Yep. And that's a frightening thing when you're out there publishing and promoting authors, and you think, well, am I next, or am I? You know, that's, we should.
Anyone listening live right now, we're fading out with about 5 seconds left, so thank you for tuning in this evening. The rest of the show will be available in the archive, but we do appreciate you listening. Sorry for interrupting there, Ellie, but just wanted to let people
know.
No,
I'm sorry. Thank you, everybody.
But we can continue on for just a couple more minutes here if there's anyone. I know Amanda, I didn't ask you if you wanted to read anything yet. you want to do
it. Yeah, we didn't hear from Amanda. Maybe one of our poems.
I'm just looking at what I've got open here on the computer at the moment. Ellie, I think I sent this through to you to look at the other day, but I sent you the earlier draft, so I'll read the final one of it.
Okay.
It's called The Water Diviner.
Mm.
You'll be confident at first. There are 1,000 ways to find water. You'll wait on the reeded banks for something resembling a seasonal flow, but the stream tastes of silt and spiked cocktails. When it shrinks to puddles and eddied mud, you'll shrug and take up your dowsing rod, certain you'll find a sweet water spring or some other way to slake your thirst. But satisfaction, like romance, will elude you, and you'll walk on through the strange familiar, laughing it off as the leaves shrivel and the ground becomes sand. Your smile will split your parched lips. You'll stumble on dew gathered in curled leaves, inviting in the pre-dawn grey, but not enough to sustain you. Like salt, it will only make you need more. Your breath will become a desert wind, ragged in your throat. This pattern of almost but never quite will continue until the dry spell becomes a drought. And when it finally rains, you'll come so close to drowning, you'll forget for a moment what it is to have oxygen in your lungs instead of water, and what it feels like to actually breathe.
Sweetie. Hey, Scott, can I read one back to Amanda? It's the one that you published from us.
Yes, absolutely.
For Amanda, when mammals face...
I love this one.
Mammals, yeah, when mammals face death, let go, blow out every pain. As a whale lets go her air, immense, she sighs. As such an enormous mammal might when facing extinction, she heaves and shudders, so exposed. Everything she's ever fought for is on the line tonight, this month, year. Every damn krill turned to energy to nurse a calf, and now she is afraid of dying, but also so very afraid of forgetting to breathe, of giving up and failing her children. Can she surface, or will the weight sink her deep into a place she can never escape? Watch the bubbles trace a path to the light. She will follow them, even as her lungs scream and she strives for one last day of normal, one more moment of peace, stroking useless and complacent. This is the end or the beginning. They blur together, hot and cold. Water, and she can't tell anymore where one begins and the other ends. It's from my Amanda.
Very nice.
I love that one.
Oh, no, it's gonna make me cry. Oh, don't cry. No, you know me. I just do. I love you guys.
I love her.
Mary, do you have anything you'd like to share tonight?
No, I'm good tonight, thank you. I don't even have any of my poems with me. I'm hiding from my children.
Okay. Well, you're welcome to call back in another night. If you ever want to share anything, you're more than welcome to. And I guess
Mary has a beautiful voice, and she's like pushing and working and fighting and like. It's really cool at our press. We have an AH workshop now where, you know, we can share poems with each other and help each other. And that's so special, I think. So special.
It's great to hear the feedback.
I think I have a piece that I'd like to share. Sort of goes along with the theme from Paul's book. Earlier this month was the 6-year anniversary of when I started being a weekly contributor at the Dissident Voice newsletter, their Sunday poetry page. And so this was the piece that commemorated that 6-year anniversary, originally from my book, Happy Hour Hallelujah. It's called Detoxification. Chaos enters the spaces of stagnation, not to obliterate, but to break down what is not working, so the inherent pattern of order can emerge in a new light, and the holy path of inward peace can once again be seen clearly. The choice to destroy is not necessarily negative, but sometimes absolutely necessary as a way to tear apart a dilapidated structure so a more solid foundation can be established upon which to build a temple of health, happiness, and love. Life is not always easy, but the trials and tribulations are inherent in the process of progression as a way to push evolution forward. And the challenges that naturally arise are a godsend of grace presented to teach the lesson that we are creatures of adaptation and survival. I just wanted to break that one out. I think it fit in with the theme overall from tonight. And then turn things over for one last piece from Paul to close us out here tonight, if you would, sir.
Certainly. Thanks, Scott. And I love that line, the trials and tribulations are inherent in what is essentially, you know, the theme of my book too, which is disintegration, in order to come back stronger. I'd really like to finish with one of the positive poems from the collection, which was also a very fond memory and recollection from me. And it's called After School. After school, we laughed about UFOs at the end of class. Your dad had seen one over the moors east of the village. You smiled and told me you were walking home. We stopped at the crossroads between Shirdley Hill and the bypass to pick gooseberries from farmland. It's because you believed me, you said, when I asked you, why me? I'd never felt so alive.
Very nice. And all your poems tonight were excellent. Everyone, great show. Thank you for calling in. Everything that y'all do at Animal Heart Press, keeping that positive energy and that community spirit alive during these challenging times that everyone's going through. You're all doing wonderful work, and it's much appreciated.
And Scott, you keep reaching out and letting us come and share here in such a safe space, and we are so grateful to you for that. Like,
I love that we have a voice here, Scott. Thank you.
Absolutely.
So
it's my pleasure.
Thanks for having me, Scott. Thank you very much.
Hey, great talking with you, Paul, and congratulations on the new book and continued success.
Well done, Paul.
Cheers to you too, ma'am.
Love you guys.
Love
y'all.
For tuning in tonight, and be back next Monday, 8 p.m. Eastern. And going to close the show out with the second half of Mickey's Poetry Cafe. This is the English version of her poem that she read in Italian earlier. This is The Coin. Have a great evening, everyone. Selah.
Thank you, Scott.
Thanks, Scott.
Thomas. Hello, everybody.
Bye.
Well, last time I read the poem in Italian that was called La Moneta, and today I'm going to read it to you in English, The Coin. Thank you. I've never been so close to anything. At most, I heard the muffled sound as a coin dropped on the grass. But I was somewhere between sky and earth, with a hammer in the chest, beneath my ivory shield, not yet scratched from struggles or from concupiscence. And there are hurricanes with minor force. There are fierce animals that are meek. But is there a fire without pain if I throw the flesh in it? and know ways to avoid and to tame. I am unaware of how to keep the bodily drugs at bay, and I know nothing about sentimental accusations or of love theorems. No, nothing that makes any sense. But I know something about money, about how it shines in the hand of the miser. And I know that fate is written on both sides of the coin, that blinds in the sun, obscuring the vision. And there it is, the best conquest and the worst defeat overall. This is the most reasonable thing that could ever happen, for sure. Thank you, Thomas. Thank you, everybody, for stopping by, and hope you liked it, and catch you next time.